In Ephesians chapter 3 this morning, I wanted to greet you in the name of the Lord and also greet those who are joining us by live stream. My thoughts have been going back to Ephesians a lot lately as the Lord leads us and teaches us. I believe a big part of that leading and teaching is the Lord connecting things together for us. So the single, the work of God and the will of God, the purpose of God, that central, the foundational part of God and His work, it kind of like rises up out of Scripture. And so then you can see how things fit together, how things are connected. Amen. So the Scripture really is not like it's not a composite of a snapshot here and a snapshot here and we're just extracting something from this generation. It's not that we're just extracting something from this one record of Joseph's life, that they all flow together. They all find a common purpose in this purpose. The book of Ephesians particularly highlights this grand purpose, this high vantage point of the work of God. Ephesians 3 verse 11 is our text, but there's going to be several texts out of the book of Ephesians that we'll consider this morning. According to the eternal purpose which He purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord. Now that text, that verse, is actually in the middle of a sentence. He's saying according to, as obviously he's talking about something that this is in the middle of a thought that's flowing. You know what the Lord's doing in the church. He's talking about in verse 10, showing the manifold wisdom of God. This is according to the eternal purpose. So the eternal purpose is like it's a governing plan. Yeah. Oh, that every part of the gospel is connected into this eternal purpose. So when we read about this eternal purpose or the purpose of God in the Scripture, we're not talking about a different segment disconnected to the gospel. Yeah. We're not talking about something that is disconnected from our partaking of the divine nature. This is not something that is just laying in wait for future times. This is the gospel is connected to the eternal purpose. There's nothing in salvation that is irrelevant or disconnected from the eternal purpose. It all fits in to the eternal purpose. So we might call the eternal purpose a grand scheme. That the eternal purpose is not going to end at the end of the world. It's an eternal purpose. Amen. The gospel is like the gospel has been born out of this eternal purpose. So the eternal purpose is not over when the devil is chained and thrown into the pit. The eternal purpose is not over when all things are brought into one in Christ Jesus. All these things fit into the eternal purpose, but it's a grand scheme. It's like a master plan. This is the master plan. There's different stages. There's things unfolding. There's different dispensations. There's different times, different aspects, different layers, you might say. But there's a master plan to what God is doing. And it's called the eternal purpose. In the eternal purpose, we see the final design. I don't mean the end. I mean the design is finalized. This is, you know, in construction, we have different kind of projects called design build. That is, we don't really know how this is going to go. We're designing it as we build it. That's what we mean by that. The eternal purpose is not design build. Amen. He knows the end from the beginning.
Yes.
And so the eternal purpose is everything that God is doing is anchored in this eternal purpose. And it's in Christ Jesus. So everything is stemming from that. There are no deviations from the eternal purpose. It's not like there's never a suspending of the purpose in order to deal with this unforeseen situation, this unpredicted situation where there's no suspending in order to deal with it, and then we'll come back. Men's work can be like that, where you just don't have any other option other than to make a deviation or to make a compromise. Or the eternal purpose doesn't, it's not like that.
Yeah.
God doesn't work like that. There's also no change orders.
Yeah, that's right.
There's no back to the drawing board.
Yeah.
You hear that phrase a lot. Well, back to the drawing, or I didn't see that coming.
Yeah, that's right.
That's all men's experience. That's not divine experience.
Amen.
He knows the end from the beginning. Now, a set of blueprints that is a working set of prints will have a site plan.
Yes.
And it's good to review this site plan because it shows you from a high vantage point the whole project.
That's right.
So you can see where it fits into the geography of the town, of the block. There'll be an elevation plan where you can see what this is going to look like, how much ground work is going to be done, you know, in the project. See, so there's different layers to, boy, some sets of blueprints can be they can be massive. There's a lot of information in these, but there's certain sheets that are critical. Like if you only got detail pages, Brother Bob, how would you like to bid a job that all you got was the detail pages? It'd be disastrous because you wouldn't see how it would fit into the overall plan. So the Lord he's made humanity privy to the eternal purpose of what he is doing. Now there's detail snapshots as well. Ultimately, all the work is going to be completed to the architect's approval.
Amen.
God is going to, just at the end of this creation, he said, it is very good.
Yeah.
He's going to say that again. With regards to this eternal purpose,
yeah,
all things are brought together in one in Christ, and he's going to say, this is very good.
Yeah.
So there are no special cases that will be considered in where the eternal purpose could be altered or changed. There's no special cases. There's no personal interests are not going to be considered. The Sanballat and Tobias are not going to be given a voice, even though they're crying out, you know, for a hearing, for a to be given a listen. No weapon formed against this purpose is going to prosper. There are weapons formed against it, just like there are weapons formed against you, against all the people of God. But it's one thing for a weapon to be formed; it's another thing for it to prosper.
That's right,
Brother Bob.
You know, look at a blueprint when I get on the job site, the first thing I look for is the architect's seal and that it's signed by the building department. And so as you were talking, I was thinking about this. You know, God's eternal purpose, he's put his seal on it, but Christ has come along and validated it with his own blood.
Yes.
He's set this salvation is a critical part of God's eternal purpose. It's not the whole thing you've already mentioned. But see, this part that is critical, you're talking about critical pages. See, the Christ taking away sin was like one of the most critical pages of the whole work. And see, this is overlooked. We just don't accept everything. When people come in and say, well, there's a change, and they show me a piece of paper, and I'm not going to change it to that piece of paper. I got to go back to the plan and make sure that the architect signed off on this. Otherwise, you're going to have a lot of confusion. I think a lot of the bad work that's been done in the church has been done by men that have decided to change something that they never went back and got approval.
Yes.
This was never, in other words, the architect never promoted this change. It was something they decided to do.
Yeah.
And so what you end up with is the end work, if it's not taken corrected, and God will correct it. But I mean, the end work will be, it'll be messed up. Something will not fit in at the end because, like you've already said, men do not have the capacity to comprehend the extensiveness of an eternal purpose.
Yeah. Really good.
Now, this is involved in
seeking first the kingdom of God.
Yes.
Now, this eternal purpose, most Christians live and die and don't have an intelligent thought about this.
Yeah.
Some people say, what is all? Tell you what it's all about. It's all about winning as many people as you can.
Uh-huh.
That's what they think the purpose is. Now, this is what they think the purpose is. I was raised under institutional emphasis that this is what they said the purpose was.
Yeah.
Now, that's number two, helping people, being kind. And that's what they think God is doing. Well, all of that is included underneath. But see, this is purpose. This isn't evident. People have to seek this.
Mm-hmm.
This is not evident. As I say, many people, they were well up in years before they had any extended thought.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Some of them don't even know this verse is in the Bible.
Yeah.
You know, they weren't, the term eternal purpose is like Ukrainian language to them. They were understanding this at all. So you're on to something
yes.
that is very significant that very few people, even in history,
uh-huh.
have seen this.
That touches the caveat of what I want to get at here in this class is that the details are only manageable when you can connect them into the overall purpose. Otherwise, you know, we've all heard the phrase, you miss the forest for the trees. The details can be exploded into thinking that some detail is the overall purpose, and that's what it gets people off one side to the other, and that I believe is one plausible explanation for all kinds of different denominations, because one conviction is that this is what it's all about, and so people follow that way. Somebody else says, no, this is what it's all about, and people go follow them and go that way. And so in each at least in the major divisions and denominations established, you have this one that they emphasize this one thing over at the sacrifice of other things. You know, in broad terms, these people emphasize the spirit over everything else, and these people emphasize faith over everything else. Well, faith is critical, and the spirit is critical. But see, fitting all these things together, they all find their purpose in this eternal purpose. So we're by preaching on the Holy Spirit or by preaching on faith, we're not sacrificing some other aspect of redemption. It's the eternal purpose that all of these find commonality and find functionality all together.
All denominations are built around a purpose.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. That's
yeah.
right.
Like Catholicism is built around authority.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
And others built around whether or not you receive, quote, the baptism of the Holy Ghost. If you're a Nazarene, it's a sanctification. See, all of them have a statement of purpose, but they all miss the point because uh-huh. you can't make a sect out of God's eternal purpose.
Amen.
That's right.
You
Amen.
You cannot do it.
Yes.
You've got to depart from it to make a heresy or a sect.
Yeah. Yeah. Let us.
Go ahead.
I was just going to say, let us, if we come up against this kind of perspective, let us remind people, ask the question, how could anything eternal have something of the earth at its center?
Yeah, that's
like
right.
people.
Yeah, that's
you know,
right.
People can't be the center of this.
Yeah.
They cannot.
I was thinking in this that the only thing that you can just focus on in this is Jesus. This is only one thing, like you're saying, you can't just focus on the Holy Spirit, but you can focus on Jesus and see God's eternal purpose. I was also thinking that this is part of working out your salvation with fear and trembling. Because you can't tell one person, you got to do this, and this is how you work out your salvation. Each person has to work out their salvation with fear and trembling as they're seeking first the kingdom of God.
Isaiah 46, Isaiah 46:10 says, he declares the end from the beginning, and from ancient times the things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure. That's kind of the, you know, you could think of that as like the thesis statement of the eternal purpose. God is doing his counsel will stand, and he's doing all his pleasure. This is God is he's doing what he wants. God, in other words, God is expressing his desire and his will in the eternal purpose. That's what it is. So in an attempt to define this a little more precisely, eternal purpose. Purpose, of course, one of those words that can be used in so many different ways. Purpose is this eternal purpose is his intention. But when we talk about God's intention, we're not there are no contingencies. When I say my intention, I use the word intention because there are contingencies that are out of my control that I couldn't do anything. So well, it's my intention. But when God has an intention to do something, this is his purpose. This is what he's going to do. It's the will of God. See, it's like you can I wouldn't know which way to say it for sure, because they're so closely related. Did the purpose of God result from the will of God, or is the will of God an expression of the purpose of God? See, they're so closely intertwined. They're both an expression of God himself, of his nature, his good pleasure. A phrase used in the book of Acts, I think, is good to use here. His determinate counsel. This is his determinate counsel, is the purpose of God, the eternal purpose. The word itself, purpose, I found interesting, means to set forth. It's to set it out. This is the purpose. It's to divulge, or to exhibit, or to expose. This is the purpose. It's to reveal what he's doing.
This eternal purpose is God's purpose concerning men.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
And the world. God did things before, and he'll do things after, but this is his purpose. In other words, God only tells men what he's doing with men.
Uh-huh.
He doesn't elaborate on anything else. Uh-huh. Unless it's the destruction of principalities and powers.
Another aspect of this that I want to labor to unfold is that the purpose it has to do with showing the reason behind what is being done, motive and outcome. What began the work and the end of the work. So it's one thing to know the facts of what God is doing. And we do, obviously, we have to know the facts of what God is doing. The eternal purpose opens the aspect of why God is doing it. See, if all you knew from the scripture is that God forgives sin, that's critical. We have to know that. God forgives, he takes away sin. But there's a reason behind why he's taking away sin, and the forgiveness is not the end of the matter. There's an end result. So forgiveness is part of the work, and the work goes on. There's more after you're forgiven. See, that starts to touch the purpose. It's unfolding and flowering out. So has the Lord drawn up this purpose as a defense against the fall of Lucifer? See, that can't be where that couldn't be the genesis of the eternal purpose, is because Lucifer fell. He purposed it in Christ Jesus. Or is this eternal purpose being worked out to fill some deficiency that was discovered in the divine nature? Or does the eternal purpose indicate some forthcoming change in the divine nature? Or in God? These questions sound strange because of your understanding of the eternal purpose. You know that doesn't fit with what God has revealed. This is not the way God changes. Not this eternal purpose can't be because there's some shift coming in the divine nature, or because of any other strange idea. But see, the reason things may some message. Or proposed prophecy in the name of the Lord. Maybe it has a strange sound to it, something's just not quite right about it, when you as you're judging the spirits, this is just not right. Maybe you can't express it at this point exactly, but it may sound strange because of your understanding of the purpose of God, that it doesn't fit in. See, it's real popular today to say, this is what God's doing this year. This is what God's doing now. As if there's an ebb and flow and some sort of unexpected, unexplainable revelation in the purpose of God. God, all things are being done according to the eternal purpose which He purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. So the eternal purpose is more than just the facts of what God is doing. There are facts of what God is doing, that Jesus is coming again. That's a fact. We preach that, we believe that, we wait for that, we hope in that. That's a fact. But it's not all over when Jesus appears. So just the fact of His appearing is not the purpose.
Dealers of, quote, heaven, if you can't see this eternal purpose and you think that the real purpose all has to do with getting people into Christ, then that being fulfilled, or they have nothing left to do when you get to glory but sit on a cloud, you know, and that's about it. See, it impacts us, where if you don't have an idea about the eternal purpose, you know that this everything on earth is preparatory.
Yeah.
It's not the conclusive thing at all. It's,
amen.
It's preparatory.
Praise God, yes.
I can testify to that point. The group I was in before, the reason why I believed that people would live forever on the earth, because I didn't have an idea about heaven. I thought, you know, what's going on in heaven? The Lord created this for me to live in, and this is why I'd like to live here in a perfect world, you know? Mm-hmm. So unless you know that, you won't really have a desire for it.
Uh-huh.
That's right.
When God created individuals in His image, after His likeness, just by the very nature of Him doing that, it imposed upon them the implication to seek Him, to know the one that created Him, and the desire God put in us, the desire to know and to understand God. Now, that's no dog or no animal or no creature. They're not sitting around trying to figure out who God is. But see, man, this is a different thing. He's created a personality that has the capacity, to some degree, whatever degree He gave them, to know and understand God. Now that, so now you look at it from the other, from He wants to be known. This is the whole reason. His eternal purpose is to divulge or to expose, which is the idea of purpose anyway. Who He is, his characteristics. What advantage would there be to be a God that was all powerful and all knowing and all wise, and no one ever knowing? So see, God's devised means by which He can expose, and not just expose it, and people sit around and say, "Did it thunder?" So that they would know and understand and be able to respond and actually bless God with their understanding of Him. Mm-hmm.
And even that, see, it has to have an objective in the end.
Oh, yes, amen.
So it's preparatory. The person should be able to reason if the world is going to be burned up.
Uh-huh.
Like God said, then God's purpose cannot be fundamentally in the world.
Amen.
See, so a person should be just to think it out.
Mm-hmm.
If I'm going to die, which all men's going to die, then the main thing can't be what I'm doing now.
Uh-huh.
That's right. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Here's another fact of what God did. He fed Israel with manna. It hadn't been done before, hasn't been done since. You couldn't reproduce it scientifically. The rock followed them that gushed the water. They were miraculously sustained in a land that couldn't sustain them.
Yeah.
So there's a fact of what God did, is He gave them manna and He gave them water out of a rock. But that the manna wasn't the purpose. We can see now how that manna fit into the overall purpose, because there's another nourishment now, that God is sustaining his people in a land that can't sustain them.
That's right.
It's a miraculous nourishment. See, but so the facts of what God's doing are not the whole purpose. They fit into the purpose, and that these facts then they bloom out. You can see so much more in them than what Israel saw because of the eternal purpose. Brother Gene.
This made me think of the crowd there that ate the bread and the fish. They thought the purpose was the food.
Right.
That was the whole point, you know. And when the Lord spoke to them about food that doesn't perish, what's that? They weren't interested in that. They wanted more bread and fish or some other something for their bellies. Mm-hmm. So that word itself separated them and sifted their hearts and revealed what they wanted in connection with God's eternal purpose. Even though Jesus didn't use the words, he did refer to it in this food that doesn't perish.
Mm-hmm. If an eternal purpose changes how you view what's happening in the world. Like for instance, if people say we need a godly nation. No one's against a godly nation.
Yeah.
But if you have eternal purpose, all God has to have is one nation to work with the idea of nation. Mm-hmm. All he needs really is one nation, and that's the only one he made. One, see that it changes how you view everything. You don't if he's seen in the family, he just needs like one family. He doesn't need Abraham. Well, he's just family. You don't have to have a lot of others because the purpose isn't that detailed. The purpose is understood more fully by that detail. Mm-hmm.
Sister Jane?
We've kind of been going round and round this and kind of saying the same thing in different ways. But facts are useless unless you know how to put them together and work with them.
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
You could dump a whole barrel full of facts in the middle of the floor, and we could sort through them, pick out the facts we like the best. But unless we knew how to work with them or what their importance were or how they fit with anything else, it's just baggage.
Mm-hmm.
Well, yeah. Information without a reason and without some wisdom to know how to work with it is actually detrimental in a lot of places.
Yes, that's
and that's what the church has done. They've picked out some things. They think that sounds real good. But they haven't put it together with everything else, so it doesn't function properly.
There's been several comments recently that have been made about the error of connecting the Passover feast with the Lord's table. There are likenesses, of course, some shadows, but from one to the other. But that kind of error of reinstituting. People are reinstituting a lot of the feasts, a lot of the Jewish ways that were given by God. But that exposes ignorance of the eternal purpose, how things all fit together.
If there was a parallel, then the fast Passover would have remembered Moses.
Yeah,
that would have been a parallel.
Yeah. See, the flood of Noah's day and his salvation in the ark, we can see, I mean, the parallels are obvious, you know, that the ark was prepared and to the saving of his house, and he was saved by water and the parallel of baptism, and all these things are we can see more. We can see why the Lord did this. Because of what else has been revealed about the eternal purpose. But without knowing the eternal purpose, then you would wonder, like, why hasn't God destroyed the earth again and again and again? Because he destroyed it with a flood because of the condition of men's hearts, right? Well, men haven't, in general, or by nature, men haven't got better since the flood. So why? Why did he just do it once? We see the eternal purpose. See it, where you can see how it fits in. It explains the facts, then become usable and workable and productive.
If he did destroy, you wouldn't learn any more than you did from the one.
That's right.
Brother Jeremy?
Something bad to happen. I heard somebody say one time that, you know, this was a secular, this ungodly woman, but she said, we should never teach our children about Noah because that was just terrible what happened. Okay, so she didn't see the eternal purpose. She has no clue of what God's doing eternally. It wasn't about, it was bigger than just a bunch of people dying. But if you don't see the eternal purpose, that's all you can see.
So the purpose is about the reason behind the facts, not just the facts themselves, and the end to which the work is done. The word that eluded me a little bit earlier is objective. Purpose is about motive and objective. Yeah. You see, the reason that it was done, what motivated the flood, and the objective. It's like a lot of the things that were done in these earlier times before Christ had come. It's like they were seeds being sown,
that's right.
And they bloom later.
Uh-huh.
And the eternal purpose is what opens these things up. So part of the eternal purpose, Jesus said, is that it's the Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom.
That's right. Yeah.
This is one of the something that's going to take place in the world to come. This is the direction in which we are going. So it's not, salvation is not just an enterprise of pity.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Is that the Lord was just moved with pity because we were so pitiful. No, he's going to give us the kingdom. This is involved in reigning with Christ in his throne. And of being over 10 cities. Be thou over 10 cities. This is the direction that this whole salvation is moving towards. So, see, the forgiveness of sins, of course, it's part of that. But it's not just about being forgiven. It's about being made capable of possessing the kingdom, like Daniel saw the saints possess the kingdom.
Which was something that God obviously couldn't just speak into somebody. This had to be this eternal purpose is not like I'm going to do it this way just because it's special or whatever. It's just a way that it has to be done. It can't be a cop. Well, you know even in yourself, when you first started at the job you had no idea what you were going to know now. Now you look back and all the processes that it took for you to get where you're at now, they were part of the equation. They were part of you understanding and being able to be profitable where you're at right now. Mm-hmm. So if you didn't have that experience, you couldn't just hire somebody on the street and say, I want you to do what Brother Aaron's doing right now. They would have no idea what you're talking about. So in the ages to come, when he says, be thou over 10 cities, you'll go right to work. You'll know exactly what to do because he's prepared you. Christ has done his job right, and you're ready to reign with Christ.
That's the way the spiritual gifts work.
Yes.
As you can see it.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
The person who's gifted doesn't have to be told what to do or when to do it.
Mm-hmm.
They go. They show mercy. That's what they've been given. They know when to show mercy and how to show mercy. They have to be instructed. A real teacher knows what to teach and when to teach.
Mm-hmm.
So that's our introduction. We get a little sampling of what's to come.
Yes, amen.
We sing, we've heard songs, and in fact, we sing songs that say, I know not why. There are some things that we have to confess we don't know. But I do know why Jesus came and died for my sins. And I know that there's probably a place for that type of expression and for that sentiment. But the eternal purpose explains why. There we see the reason. And, you know, people are taught very commonly that the Lord works in mysterious ways. And the some of the conclusions made from that is that the more holy something is, the less you'll understand about it. I can't accept that.
Yeah.
There are people that say, you know, this is the greater the work God does, the less you can explain about it, the less you will understand. It's just God. People talk like this. Well, Paul had a lot to say, and a lot to open up. John could open up a lot, put a handle on what God did. Yeah. Brother Gene.
Yeah.
understanding doesn't take away from the wonder.
Amen.
And the amazing factor of it. And our ability to fellowship in it. And to have this giving and receiving. What Brother Gibbon said the other day, reciprocity. We have this giving and receiving. We buy and sell. We trade this truth. Mm-hmm. And we joy in it. We rejoice in it. So that doesn't take away from it. The knowing and the understanding doesn't. It enhances it.
Hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, this, I don't know why and this sort of thing. That at the very best, that's a juvenile.
Uh-huh.
As a juvenile statement, and as you grow up into Christ, you should be saying that less.
Yeah.
Yes, yes.
Not
mm-hmm.
more.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Amen.
Some things that look mysterious, I could actually cite a lot, 100 reasons why it seems perfectly reasonable that happened. Was it good or bad? Like, you can figure it out.
Yes, yes.
Yes.
Here's another contrast with regards to knowing and not knowing the eternal purpose of God. It's possible to be a very religious people and kill the Son of God for religious reasons.
Yes. Yes.
The eternal purpose wasn't, it was a mystery.
Yeah.
Wasn't known. It's possible to think that Jesus is a specialist in catching fish that have money in their mouths.
Right.
And that's what you seek for. I know there's got to be more fish out there that are bearing money in their mouths. But he only did it once.
Yeah.
It could be that people follow Jesus only to have their water turned into wine.
Mm-hmm.
He did turn water into wine.
Yeah.
But to make that the main thing is going to make you very disappointed.
Yes, it is.
So strange ideas are born out of not knowing the purpose of God. The eternal purpose. In fact, the Lord said, "My people perish for lack of knowledge." So we're talking about the big picture, the grand scheme, the master plan, and how that fits in. You know, life can be an experience of difficult experiences and confusing experiences that you can't say this is that. Now you're faithful. If you're faithful through those things, there will come a day where you can say this is that. But not everything is revealed about your trial at the beginning of the trial.
Mm-hmm.
We know that.
Yeah.
In fact, we're only given a day at a time, and that's a mercy from the Lord. But what I'm talking about is that experience, that detail of one day at a time, can be too hard to bear without knowing the eternal purpose. So what the Lord is doing in the earth is much bigger than the earth. You know, to make the world a better place. How many times have you heard that?
Yeah.
To make the world a better place. And what he is doing for men is bigger than man. See, this can explain a lot.
Mm-hmm.
This can make life much more savory to know that what God is doing in men is not just for men. It's for his own glory and for the world to come, and for personalities in heaven, in heavenly places,
mm-hmm.
in high places.
You remember what Paul said about people who mind earthly things?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Whose end is destruction. So that's a startling revelation. That
yes.
exposes a lot of stuff.
Mm-hmm. And also, similar to that, Peter talked about a condition where you cannot see afar off.
Right.
See, that's what to live looking down at the earth, like just the here and the now, is a serious handicap. That's cannot see afar off. In fact, a seeing afar off is what makes the here and now doable.
Uh-huh.
That's what makes it manageable. That you can, I know that my Redeemer lives and that he will stand on the earth in the latter day. See, that was like the long view for Job. That he, and it was, I'm not saying that you should just be carefree and never cry, always laugh. And I'm not talking about silly stuff like that. I'm talking about being faithful and persevering and being able to endure and give thanks always. How about that?
Yeah.
If all you knew and all you could see is the here and the now, giving thanks always is just, it's just more than you can do. But seeing afar off, see, this empowers the perspective of seeing afar off, the eternal purpose makes, oh, giving thanks always. Well, now that makes sense because of the eternal purpose of God. So this purpose starts with God and it ends with God. He didn't start it in us. It starts in Him and it ends with Him. All things are of Him and to Him and for Him. And Jesus is the Alpha and the Omega. So it has a divine genesis and it has a divine conclusion.
Amen.
So this eternal purpose is not a response or a reaction.
Yeah.
Oh, men sinned. Now we have the eternal purpose. Oh, the eternal purpose is before the world began. And also this it means that this eternal purpose was drawn up unilaterally, not multilateral. So there's no board of directors that there has to be a vote, you know, to see what we're going to do, what we're not going to do, which direction we're going to go, and that kind of thing. It's unilateral. It's the eternal purpose of God. It's all of Him. So God, as the architect and engineer, has commissioned Jesus as the builder of this purpose. Our text says it is purposed in Christ Jesus. It's found in Him. And the good pleasure of the Lord is prospering in His hand. So go ahead.
God's purpose is part of Himself.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. He's never been without this.
Amen.
Without this purpose.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. This fits very nicely into what Jesus said. If any man would follow me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Because the purpose didn't start in me. The purpose has its origin in God and its conclusion in God. And so it makes good, reasonable sense then that to be a part of that purpose, you have to deny yourself. Because it's His purpose. Take up your cross and follow Him. That's the glory of the gospel, is that we're partaking of His work and of His nature and actually of His promises.
All sin and all frustration happened because a person didn't deny himself.
Yeah, that's right.
Yes, amen. Yes.
And all false teachers and all false doctrine has something of that in common as well, is that it promotes men. Promotes self. It promotes what you want. It promotes what I'm doing. And all the while, this is what got the human race in trouble at the very beginning. And somehow, that original temptation of you, mm-hmm. has found its way into religion. Now we have a religious form of you.
We live in a political, social culture that magnifies that and emphasizes that and fights and dies for individual purpose and choice. We need to remember that.
Romans 8:28. We know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to His purpose. That's when all things work together for your good. Is when you're in this purpose. This is the purpose of which His counsel is going to stand, and He's going to do all of His will. And then when you're in that purpose, that's when all things work together for your good.
Yeah,
that fits together. So that's reasonable. That if I'm part of what God's doing, then it all works together for my good. Not because of a personal agenda. He's not making sure that what you've decided to do, that it prospers. It's not on an individual basis. All things work together for them who are the called according to His purpose.
Amen.
So it's impossible to be in this purpose and lose.
Amen.
It will never happen. There will be enemies, and there are enemies. But all things work together for the good. Not all things work together for the enjoyment. All things work together for the good. There will be opposition, and there will be suffering and even losses. Mm-hmm. There's we have famous records and books and Fox's Book of Martyrs, and it looked like, from men's perspective, that those believers lost, mm-hmm. that they lost their battle, but all things work together for their good. Romans 9, verse 11, is talking about Jacob and Esau. For the children being not yet born, neither having done any good or evil, that the purpose of God according to election might stand, not of works, but of him that calleth. This to establish that men are fitting into what God is doing. God is not responding to what men do. Now, this can be hard for people to accept and just to say amen to. And here's the reason why I think people have a hard time with that, is because there's an underlying danger of thinking that God has done something that's not right. That God, if God's making all the decisions, and somebody doesn't agree with that, then they thought that God's made the wrong decision.
Yes.
That's the only reason that somebody would take issue with God. We've all heard this argument probably, that God can't be up there just deciding that you're in and you're out. There's something motivating that type of statement, as if God is choosing somebody to go to heaven that doesn't want to, and that he's keeping somebody out that does want to. No, he is that the purpose of God according to election might stand. His purpose is 100% righteous. And God is going to be vindicated in all of his works. He is just in all of his doings. Now, when you have that settled in your heart, mm-hmm. that God has and will do nothing that's wrong, well, then it's a lot easier to say amen at a text
amen.
Like this. That it's according to election that the purpose of God might stand. God's not reacting to human affairs, not in regards to his purpose. Not in regards to his purpose. He does bear long with them. But see, he's not suspending his purpose in bearing long. Brother Gibbon?
In other words, man's expressions interfere with God's purpose, see?
Mm-hmm.
Yet the purpose of God according to election might stand. But the only thing that will fit in with that is what God does. What mm-hmm. man does doesn't fit in there.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Amen. Now, God does respond to men. What we have to draw some distinction here is that it's the purpose of God is not changeable and negotiable. Mm-hmm. And so God responds. See, God responds to prayers. God can be provoked mm-hmm. by someone. God was provoked by Israel. Mm-hmm. God can be provoked to bless too. So God does respond to men. What I'm saying is that the eternal purpose is not being driven and altered by his response.
Yeah, the response of God is not in any inferior sense,
uh-huh.
as if men can control him in
some way. That's why John said, if we ask anything according to his will, you'll receive it. There's no question about it.
Yeah. Amen.
God works all things according to his purpose. So if you ask something that's in accord with that purpose, you get it.
Yeah.
There's no question about it.
Mm-hmm.
Which kind of is a commentary on unanswered prayers.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm.
Ephesians 1, verse 11, it says, in whom also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestinated according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will. So God is his own counselor with regards to the eternal purpose. He works all things after the counsel of his of his own will. So there's no debating. You know, in the democracy, there's debating, a hearing of this side and hearing of that side, and they vote in this house and it approves, but it's not done till it goes to the other end of the house, and they have to vote and see. There's this give and take and push and pull and all this big process. Well, in the heavenly chambers, the heavenly house, there's the council of his own will.
Amen.
That's how it's being worked out.
Yeah.
Brother Bob?
If your name is Ishmael, and God will hear the request of Abraham. He'll say, I heard you, but you're still going to have to leave. You're still going to have to leave because, see, according to his purpose, Ishmael had to leave. He couldn't be connected any longer with Isaac, and yet God still heard his prayer. Isn't that something? But he did it for respect for Abraham. But he still had to leave. So he works all these things together. And Abraham, he did fulfill what he promised to Abraham, but he also fulfilled what he was going to do with Isaac. See, Isaac was, this was like in the flow of his purpose. And yet Ishmael, even though it was a sideline, he got blessed just because Abraham wanted it. Only God can do these kinds of things. See, otherwise, they'd get very confusing in the minds of men. They would run over emotion and those kinds of things would guide their preference, but not with God. It's His eternal purpose.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Along these lines, I've thought for some time that it's wise to consider what you're praying for. Prayer time, you know, it can become a bunch of generalities. Hmm. Just someone says, pray for me, pray for me. Well, that sounds nice, but God's people got to think out what they're praying for. Because there isn't anything like this in Scripture. When somebody says, pray for me, like if Paul, you know, he had something in particular.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, same.
Yes.
It's just good, particularly as a congregation, to learn how to make intelligent prayer requests and think over.
Uh-huh.
Think over what we're saying.
Yes.
Just because someone says pray for me doesn't mean you should.
Uh huh. Yeah.
Maybe at home or something like that. But even then, you think the thing through, because the word is, I guess, give me according to his will, and receive it.
Yes. Amen.
So you have to at least have some kind of idea whether it's to that direction.
Amen. I thought, and same thing. Remember, he said to one person, he said, I don't even know if God will forgive you for that. I don't even know. I have no idea. You go ahead and pray. And he said, remember, you wanted him to pray for him. But he didn't. He
didn't pray for
you. You pray. And I don't know. Maybe God will forgive you, but I don't know. And I've had things like this in my own family. Things happen. I don't know. I don't. I have to just give it to God. I have no idea. I can't come up with a reasonable, like a reason. So I got to give it to God because He knows. I don't know.
You just say what Peter said. You pray.
Yes, that's right.
Maybe God will forgive.
Maybe.
Yeah.
That's what he told him.
Have you ever heard anybody tell you this at a prayer meeting, though? So we can't pray for that. I've never heard that before. I've never heard anybody say, no, we're not going to pray for that because. And I think there has to be some wisdom in this, but I think it is right to form godly. You got to come with God. Well, you got to have some kind of basis to pray for anything.
Like anything else in the kingdom, you can't systematize this.
Yeah, that's right.
People like to have a little manual, you know, but you can't. You just got to throw out some thoughts, and every person's got to think this thing out.
Mm-hmm.
You got to pray like a kingdom person.
Yes.
Not a sympathetic person.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I've heard people use the word prayer as a euphemism for a wish.
Oh, yeah.
Nothing more than that. Just a wish.
Uh-huh.
Or just a happy thought. Just a kind of a compilation and a digest of good, happy things.
Uh-huh.
And they state it, and they think it's a prayer. They use the term that way. So we need to make sure that Brother Gibbons said it. Be thoughtful, careful about this.
Mm-hmm.
God is in heaven, and we're on the earth.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Solomon said. Sister Jen?
A little bit of a sidebar here, but that's the strength of when we come together as an assembly, our prayers. Not for everybody to repeat the list. You know, you got 10 things. So everybody says, please, We pray for this person. We pray for that person. We pray for this thing, and we pray for that thing, and the next person. We pray for this person. We pray for that person. We pray for that thing. We pray for this thing. And go through it 30 times. But rather, the body together, as the Lord guides each of us into either knowledge or understanding or puts a burden on our heart, we're able, by the time we get done, everything is prayed for well.
Mm-hmm.
And that,
that's right.
And so that's part of this, the Lord, according to His purpose, setting us in the body and giving us insight and words to present to Him on these matters, and wisdom to know, you know, maybe it can't be prayed for exactly like it's presented. Maybe there's a better way to present this.
Right.
I've marveled over the years at how prayer meetings tend to degenerate. It's phenomenal. I can't understand it, but they somehow prayer isn't being connected with God and His purpose.
Yes, that's right.
That's what's happening, and it takes a lot of joint exhortation and endeavor to keep us up on top of the water on this, on this subject.
Yeah, these are some of the very things that motivated me to these considerations and for the class is not only will connecting our prayers with the purpose of God will it'll sanctify the prayers, but it also teaches us, you know, you think about what God's doing on this scale. See, and then there's some prayers that just kind of fall off the table, aren't there?
That's right, yeah.
It's just, this is, you know, just coming to Jesus and asking for Him to divide the inheritance. It's just not the right, thing to do, to come and ask. So, see, knowing the purpose of God, having the eternal purpose of God in our hearts and minds, and then it makes for effective prayers. That's what Brother Gibbon was talking about. He said, if you ask anything according to His will, this is what he's talking about, the purpose.
Amen.
What God's doing.
That's right.
Why wouldn't God give to someone something that they're asking for when that's exactly what He's doing?
Yeah, that's right.
See, so it brings life, knowing the purpose of God, it brings all the details of life into like the main flow.
Yeah.
Brother Gene?
I had to relieve myself from the police work is because of the idea of purpose. Some of the things that I was exposed to and attempted to take the Lord into or to connect to God and so forth couldn't do it. Could not any longer do it.
I understand.
People's personal agendas, people's personal interests, wicked, godless people who wanted you to ask God's blessing on the wreck of their life. I just couldn't do it anymore.
Well, God will bless you for that decision.
Yep, amen.
There's one more thing to say about this Ephesians 1:11, on the He worketh all things after the counsel of His own will, is that we've heard the phrase before that God is He's the self-existing one. Well, in this case, He's the self-governing one, and there's no liability to that.
Yeah, amen.
See, there's no check and balance needed in the divine nature, because He's righteous, He's holy, He's just, He's exalted, He's self-governing and after the counsel of His own will. The glory of the gospel is that He's making us partakers of that nature, of the divine nature,
amen.
And that's another way to summarize this eternal purpose of God, is that He's making us partakers of His nature. 2 Timothy 1 and verse 9 says that He hath saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to His own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began. You notice how many times when the eternal purpose is being expressed in the scripture, it's directly anchored into Christ. There's no touching the eternal purpose outside of Christ Jesus. He's the custodian. He's been the appointed worker of this of the eternal purpose. It's been given over to him. Uh-huh. It's prospering in his hand. And nobody, just like in the days of Joseph, nobody got any corn without Joseph. Nobody gets in any part of this purpose without Jesus. It's been given into his hand. So the Lord is he's sending people to Jesus. That's a good way to summarize ministry. Yep. Is sending people to Jesus. Bringing people to Jesus. If we can just, I mean, how many times do you hear this kind of thing? If we can just do this, like, this is the secret. If we can just do this, if we can just get all the churches together, if we can just get people to do this, now if we can just get people to Jesus, then he'll take it from there, so to speak.
And they say, sirs, we would see Jesus.
Yes.
And they ask Jesus, where are you staying? He didn't say, over there, Capernaum, is it covering the sea? Just
after
you too.
Yes, amen.
Here's some more summary text from the book of Ephesians. And I think of the book of Ephesians like this very often. It's like a bird, like a mountaintop view of, you know, the letter to the Corinthians. Paul had to get down like into the nitty gritty, and, you know, had to deal with some stuff and like get his hands dirty. In order to bring people up to where they could hear something,
that's right, yeah,
something like this. But the Ephesians, see, they didn't have these kind of issues, so he could address them from a higher point.
That's right.
He could cover more ground quicker, because they were already seated with Christ in heavenly places. Amen. And so you can deal with more,
yes,
from this high vantage point. So that's why we have so many of this. I can almost call this lesson an overview of Ephesians. This is what the eternal purpose. This is what he's doing. Ephesians 2 verse 21 said, "In whom all the building fitly framed together groweth unto a holy temple in the Lord, in whom ye also are builded together for a habitation of God through the Spirit."
Amen.
Now, see, that's the high, that's a high perspective, is that the whole building is fitly framed together. It is. Mm-hmm. It's not God hoping that it was. Uh-huh. It's not God working towards that. Someday the building is going to be fitly framed together. It is. Mm-hmm. It is fitly framed together. It's a, from the lower perspective, there's a lot of work to be done, and there's exhortations, there's warnings to be given. You have the Laodiceans that are, that Jesus is outside the door, knocking on the door, but he did say, "As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten." So, see, that's a two different views of the same church. This high view is fitly framed together, but there's another view of, "As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten." Yeah. Uh-huh. They're both valid views. They're from very different standpoints,
yeah,
very different points. Mm-hmm. But Here's a way to summarize the eternal purpose, is that he's going to end up with a holy temple,
yes,
in which he himself can dwell.
Amen.
That's what he's working towards.
Yes.
It's a lively, mm-hmm, like Peter said, built of lively stones, a spiritual house.
Amen.
So we're not talking about boards and stones and,
yes,
and brick and mortar. We're talking about people,
amen,
that are being built together.
That's
Brother
right.
Bob.
So you can trust God to do the right thing, because he has a vested interest in this work. This is something that his son is doing for him. So, I always do my best work when I'm doing it for the Lord. That's when I do my best work. But see, if I fall back on that and I start doing it for men, it always have complications.
Yeah.
But I know in myself, that when I do something for the Lord, it's the very best I can. And Christ is doing this for his Father. So he knows what is required. I mean, he's the only one that can do this work. He knows what's it going to take for God to inhabit something. He knows exactly what it's going to take. So, falling back on this statement you said earlier, people generally mistrust God. That's why they don't think that they have to do something other than what Christ is doing. Because, well, to make it better, you can't make it better. Christ knows exactly what needs to be done. And if we'll just trust him and follow him, it will, the work will get done. Well, actually, we'll be transformed into his image.
Yeah.
We know that God's pleased with Christ, right? Mm-hmm. So this is, you know, it's a good thought, isn't it?
Amen. The habitation, that's an example of the everlasting purpose.
Uh-huh.
An everlasting purpose has to have an everlasting objective.
That's right.
It's an objective that
that's
doesn't come to an end when it's fulfilled.
Yes, uh-huh.
Like the habitation of God.
Mm-hmm.
That's not like once it's ultimately fulfilled, now the dwelling of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and he will be their God. That's never going to like come to an end, but that is the objective. Or like this one, let, think of that in light of a word like this, let brotherly love continue.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't just mean continue here, that means everlasting. When will brotherly love cease to be an operation mm-hmm. in the world to come? Or how about this one? He says, they shall follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if, when that's ultimately realized, is that going to come to an end?
Mm.
And so that's those are the kind of aspects of this objective that have to drive some of the temporary things. And there are some like temporary things, but they're eternal because they have eternal ramifications, like the death of Christ. Jesus isn't going to die over and over again,
mm-hmm.
continue to die, but it has an everlasting ramification. You see what I'm saying there?
Mm-hmm.
And so that's how complex this purpose is. There are some temporary things in it that aren't going to continue over and over, but they're eternal by virtue that they have an everlasting ramification. But there are things that the objective itself will continue on and on and on.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, this is how we must raise our children.
Uh-huh.
There needs to be a major rethinking of how children are taught about the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
This needs to be rethought mm-hmm. because it's completely flopped.
Mm-hmm.
It has not worked. And these things we're talking about, this has to be built in from young up.
Mm-hmm.
See, well, they won't understand. Say it anyway.
Yeah.
Tell this. So there's some. See, if you try to teach your children just the Ten Commandments, and that's all you do, and right and wrong, and that's all you do, well, some of us can tell you what happens.
Mm. Yeah.
Including myself. Some mm-hmm. of us can tell you. That's not sufficient.
Mm-hmm.
That's why when God raised Israel, He taught people how to rear their
uh-huh.
children.
Yeah.
What I say, hold it all the time before your children. Hold mm-hmm. it all the time, every place they go.
Mm-hmm.
See, he taught from a child us knowing the scriptures.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
And we know that the Lord said, I dwell not in temples made with hands.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
So what we have, I believe, structures in this world because of this spiritual house that God is building. It's like a shadow of a dwelling
mm-hmm.
that God is building himself a temple mm-hmm. in his people. That is, God's investing himself yeah. in his people.
Amen.
That's seen in partaking of the divine nature. It's seen in the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. Your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit, yeah. he says. And so you got all the people in their own measure are a temple of the Holy Spirit. You put them all together and you'll have an aggregate
yes.
of a temple that God himself can dwell in.
That's right.
See, it's even made a point of God being on Mount Sinai that his foot touched the mount.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It wasn't the fullness of the presence of God. Mm-hmm. And in Isaiah's case, it was this train that filled the temple.
Yeah.
See, it wasn't the fullness, but in this, the whole building fitly framed together, builded for a habitation of God. It'll be that's the objective.
Amen.
Is the habitation of God.
God's too big
mm.
to live in one person. He's too big to live in one family. He's too big to live in one nation. He's demonstrated this, see.
Mm.
So it's going to take a innumerable company, multitude that no man can number.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, I like to think of this, build it together for a habitation. Build it together. It's like a composer when he looks out and he has an orchestra and he's going to write a piece of music. If he's wise, he's going to use, at some point in time, he's going to use every single instrument out there to write, to influence. See, his what he's creation. His creation is going to utilize everything. Just like the gifts in the church, they're not just for here. We're getting oriented to be able to use them in a much more profitable way there. To where when God expresses himself, God's very expressive, but when he has a multitude which no man can number at his disposal that he's living in, his expression's going to be, it's going to be very good.
Mm-hmm. Amen. Another way to say this is found in Ephesians 4:13. Till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, which is expressed in other places as the body of Christ. 1 Corinthians 12, now ye are the body of Christ and members in particular. And so in the temple, the Lord has depicted what he's doing in a structure. And so there's an aspect of testimony of what God's doing. But then also, he's given a testimony in the human body. Yeah. That this is, there's many, there's hands and the arms and the feet and the legs and eyes and ears. Many, many different parts, but it all makes up one body. Mm-hmm. And so, see, the work of God is so profound that he's had to employ all these different ways of expression, all these different testimonies all fit together and to show what God is doing in Christ. So in this measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, Jesus as the head, the church is going to effectively display Christ.
Yeah, amen.
Everything that Christ is going to be seen in the aggregate church, mm-hmm. in the glorified aggregate church, when all things are brought together in one in Christ.
Yeah.
Sister June?
Yeah, as you were speaking, you're talking about all of these, mm-hmm. these things that would point to that truth. Another way of looking at it is that all the works of God are harmonious mm-hmm. with his purpose. They're made that way because he's their maker, and this is what he's doing.
Mm-hmm.
So, to whatever measure and to whatever part they play in that purpose, they're going to mirror these things.
Yes, amen.
So when the Lord was doing, as he works in the earth, he does it through his body. That's why this analogy is uh-huh. being used. When you make something, you're not just thinking. That's not a creation. When your body takes your thoughts and makes something.
That's right. Amen.
Of it. It's
That's
your body right. being employed yes. to express yeah. your ideas and thoughts, your creative capacities. So what happened on the day of Pentecost looked like Peter said something and all kinds of people agreed and they joined themselves, right? But now actually he poured this forth.
Yes.
Which you now see in here. See, that's an expression of the body.
Yes.
Jesus did it, but he did it through Peter.
Amen.
And you could go all through Scripture and attach that reality to it. Was it Stephen that did that? No, it's Jesus doing it through Stephen. Was it Philip that did that? No, it was Jesus that did it through Philip. Was it Peter that did that? No, it was Jesus that did it through Peter. And so that's why he uses this analogy of the body, is that he's doing it through his people. The body of Christ is not going to be decommissioned in the world to come.
That's right.
It's not going to be out of work and retired. It's going to be complete then. It's like now we're in boot camp here. We're in kindergarten here, and that's what we sit in his throne there. And we're going to be doing his work
mm-hmm.
there, Brother Jason.
Yeah, it reminds me of these folks that there are folks out there that will say things about heaven. Well, what are we going to do? What are we going to do in heaven? It sounds really boring. It just sounds like a big church service forever and ever. Oh my goodness, who would want to go to heaven? And they don't understand that the real work is actually going to begin then.
That's right.
Yeah.
Amen.
When you get to the end of the book of Revelation, the end is actually a beginning.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's right.
But people have this idea that actually this life is the main work. And then heaven is just some kind of celestial eternal vacation or retirement. It's retirement.
Yeah.
I've actually heard people talk about that.
Hell yeah.
That you work here and then you get to retire and go to heaven.
Yeah.
And that's just a really, that's a very infantile view of,
yeah,
of things. Actually, this is preparation. Like you just said, this is preparation for the real work. It's not the real work's here, and then mm-hmm. and then you enter into some kind of eternal vacation or something like that.
Just two more in conclusion here. Ephesians 2, verse 8, and Ephesians 3, verse 10. And I had decided to end with Ephesians 3, verse 10, being the verse just before the text that we started with. It's according to his eternal purpose, which he purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord. Well, these two verses give us an eternal view of what's happening in the earth, that in the ages to come, chapter 2, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. So that's why this is like the governing purpose of everything that's happening here, is that in the ages to come we're going to display his grace. Mm-hmm. We're going to show, and we're going to exhibit an aspect of God, uh-huh, his grace. And in verse 10, chapter 3, to the intent that now unto the principalities and powers in heavenly places might be known by the church the manifold wisdom of God. Mm-hmm. So grace and wisdom. Mm-hmm. God is in investing himself in his people, he's displaying this part,
yes,
of himself in his people. Just like the children bear the image of their parents. This is what God is investing himself in his people. There's a gallery so large watching this eternal purpose that no man can even number the gallery. Mm-hmm. This is what it's being viewed. Yeah. Peter said the angels long to look into these things.
Yeah.
There's something being done in earthly places that they haven't seen before.
Yeah.
And it's grace and wisdom is being given and being worked out, being displayed, being partaken of, being tasted of in men. There's grace and wisdom at a higher level than was given in this creation. Mm-hmm. It's as a higher level of wisdom than what Solomon had. Mm-hmm. He did establish this creation in wisdom. It's what the Psalms say,
yeah,
what the prophets say. But there's a higher level of wisdom in the new creation.
Yes.
If any man be in Christ, he's a new creation.
Amen.
He said in the garden, let us make man after our own image. He said it again in Christ. He's,
yes,
there's a new creation. It's a higher level of new than what was seen in what is being seen now. So to the only wise God,
yeah,
is working all these things together, and the day of judgment, beginning in the day of judgment, and continuing world without end, God is going to be seen in what God's doing.
Amen.
And so it seems to be not strong enough to say it's important that we see the purpose of God. It's imperative,
yeah,
that we see the purpose of God. So we're being called according to this purpose. Mm-hmm. And in fact, our lives only have purpose so far as they touch that purpose.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
So, amen. Any other things before we close, Brother Jason?
Yeah, Romans 8:28 is quoted a lot. And I've heard people say some very strange things about that passage. Like I've actually heard people say, even if you sin, God will work it together for your good or something. But returning to that passage, I know we dealt with that earlier in the lesson, but that's in retrospect. And when we get to that new creation, the new world, the world to come, in retrospect, we will see,
that's right,
that even our trials are turned to gold, like Job said. Even our trials are turned to gold, because all of those things will have contributed, because we were a part of God's purpose, all of those things will have contributed,
that's right,
to our ultimate glory. Mm-hmm. Now, the opposite is true of the condemned. In retrospect, people who go to hell, all of the good things that they enjoyed in this world are going to testify against them,
mm-hmm,
for their condemnation.
Yeah. Yeah.
Even the good things that they had, mm-hmm, like Jesus said, in Jesus' parable of Lazarus and the rich man, said, you had your good things.
Mm-hmm.
But see, they testified against him at that point.
Yeah.
He didn't use any of those good things because they weren't a part of God's purpose.
Mm-hmm.
And so, all in a sense, all those things will be wasted a wasted life, wasted opportunities.
Right.
You see, with the people of God, if you're in the flow of God's purpose, nothing's wasted.
Yeah.
Amen. Amen.
But we may not see that. Like it's like the old song, we'll see, we'll understand it better by and by. There's a lot of truth in that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
There are things you go through now where you may not be able to see how is God going to use this. But eventually, in retrospect,
you'll see it. Yeah.
The trials will turn to gold, and we'll see how being in the flow of God's purpose sanctified everything.
Mm-hmm.
But not being in the flow of God's purpose, nothing sanctified.
Mm-hmm.
It'll contribute to people's condemnation.
Mm-hmm. Think about people understanding or having the right perspective about things to come. What we will do there in the presence of God and so forth. You might parallel that with the angels looking upon the dark and formless and empty earth. None of them thought, well, what's that any good for? They all rejoiced. They knew, because they knew God, they knew He was going to do something wondrous with it.
Mm-hmm.
Now that we know the Lord, He's going to do something wondrous. We may not know the details right now, but it'll be wondrous.
Amen.
Yeah, amen.
Brother Ricky?
Maybe the idea of heaven being a place of rest has been something that has been the impact of human thinking more than divine thinking.
Yeah, that's right.
Because, see, in the world, men labor and labor for this objective, is that they can one day retire and not work.
Hmm.
But you notice that ends up not becoming the kind of satisfaction that they thought it would.
That's right, yeah.
There, and people have no more purpose, and there's no drive, and so there's no satisfaction.
Yeah.
But Jesus said, the Father worketh, and I work.
Yeah.
Because in the kingdom, rest is found in the work.
That's right.
Yeah.
See, when we rest from our labors, it's ceasing from the kind of labor and toil associated with the conflict in this life, but that rest will involve an augmentation of divine working, which will make for a greater degree of satisfaction. Even in the world, you know, if you aren't involved in labor, you kind of get kind of antsy.
Uh-huh.
You got like I got a lot of free time on your hands, and you don't know how to use it. You get kind of anxious and antsy because that's just not God hadn't set us up to be that way. But when you're involved in the labor of the Lord, don't you find you're more satisfied when you're in the labor?
Yeah. Even you'll rest from those labors.
Yeah.
The contrast is with what was imposed upon man. It's the labor.
Yeah.
It's labor. We're going to rest from labor.
Uh huh.
Yeah.
So that
pointless labor.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that was part of the curse of sin.
Yeah. It's in wears you out. It's inconvenient. Yeah. It's not pleasant. You sweat at your face. Sweat at your brow.
Yeah.
That's labor. Even when you labor for the Lord, you get wore out.
Yeah.
That's true.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And we're going to be rest from labors.
Yeah. Yes.
Part of the glory of the world to come is going to be the removal of hindrances.
That's right.
So Paul said he subjected this creation to frustration.
That's right. Yes.
Well, that's going to be removed.
Amen.
There's not going to be any more of that frustration or getting tired or being or fighting the devil or dealing with the flesh. I mean, can you imagine what the people of God will accomplish in the world to come with these new bodies, with a new heavens and a new earth, where there is. We're in righteousness dwells. There's no competing influence. It's going to be amazing.
Yeah.
The glory will be amazing.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. And some people are going to have to learn to participate.
Yeah.
If they make it.
Mm-hmm.
So this is where you learn to participate. You learn to labor in it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you learn to develop a good kingdom work ethic.
Yeah. That's right. That's good.
Uh-huh. And Paul said, not that we would be unclothed, but that we would be clothed upon. Mm-hmm. Rest is not idleness.
Yeah.
And getting away from something is never as pleasant as getting to something that you want. So we're going to leave behind those things that are associated with the curse and temporality, but we're going to what we really love. And we'll not have the hindrances of the wearing out, so we can really put ourselves to it and enjoy it more fully.
Amen.
Yes, amen.
Now, even in his innocence, Adam didn't sit in the garden on a rock and listen to the birds sing. He was busy keeping and dressing the garden.
That's right.
Amen.
He put them there to dress and keep it.
Yes.
All right. Thank you for all your comments and additions, and let's have a word of prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you for revealing your purpose, and for, by your grace, for making us to partake of it. We pray that you would give us grace to grow in our understanding and our participation and our labors in your purpose. And we also thank you for this food that you've granted to us this morning and the brethren that have prepared it for us, and pray that your blessing on it and on them. In Jesus' name, amen.